My father, who was literally born in the Badlands, died with a copy of Zane Grey in his hands. And were he not already dead, if I had told him that one of the best books ever written about Wyatt Earp, Doc Holliday, and the Clintons had been written by a woman, it probably would have finished him off. But my point is not about the male chauvinism of my father, but that he instilled in my brothers and me a love for things Western. So when I saw this book's predecessor, Doc, and then this book itself coming down the pipeline, I got pretty excited and knew immediately what my brothers were getting for their birthday. And we find ourselves here tonight because we have with us the author of one of the best books ever written about the event at the center of our imaginings about the Wild West, the gunfight at the OK Corral, which, as I understand it, didn't actually take place.
In the vacant lot behind Camillus Fly's photography studio near the corner of First, a little north of the OK Corral.
I do want to mention that our author really does her research. But anyway, if you're like me, your concept of the gunfight of the OK Corral is formed by, you know, much dim and distant received wisdom informed by old westerns, drippy cowboy ballads, and numerous other pop culture references that echo faintly across the years, and probably a good deal of cognitive dissonance, given that there seem to be parallel storylines that have come down to us over time about what transpired in Tombstone on that day in 1881. Was Wyatt Earp a good guy or a bad guy? Both depictions are shooting it out in my mind. Sorry, that was the only one about the general. I was so excited about rereading the book that I didn't really write a proper ending for my introduction. let me just finish it up by saying that our author has received accolades since her first book, The Sparrow, was chosen as one of the 10 best books of the year by Entertainment Weekly, won the Arthur C. Clarke Prize, British Science Fiction Prize for Best Novel, and then her books have gone on since then. Doc, which I already alluded to, was one of the Washington Post's 3 best novels of the year, the American Library Association's best historical novel, and Epitaph is already shooting to the top of the charts. We have with us, of course, our local celebrity Nancy Pearl to talk with Miss Russell.
So Mary, long time no see. We were here at 10 o'clock this morning, so we've already done like one gig.
Wow.
Yeah, for the TV show that we tape here at the bookstore. Yeah. So that'll start in August, running in August. And because we knew we were going to be here tonight, we talked about entirely different things. So if you want an overview of Mary's career, wait till August, watch Booklust on TV, and you'll get that. And tonight we're going to talk about Doc and your newest book, Epitaph. So how'd you get interested in these Western heroes, or not heroes?
This is one of the easiest questions to answer. Two words. Val Kilmer. And I'm like, okay, Tombstone is a great movie, you know, and it's a charming portrayal. And of course, he's the first, I think it's the best on film, and he is the first one, and you have to put this down to Kevin Jarre's screenplay. Kevin Jarre did an enormous amount of research. It's the first portrayal of Doc as a Southern gentleman. It's the first portrayal of Doc as a genuine knowledgeable man who spoke French and Latin and Greek, and you know, he was an educated man of the 19th century, and he was also a very skilled oral surgeon. And that has kind of gotten lost because the character Doc Holliday, the name gets used, but he becomes like the sidekick. I assure you, John Henry Holliday never considered himself Wyatt Earp's sidekick. The term does not exist in 19th century English. It's something that happens as they start making westerns in the 1920s and 30s and 40s. So I was really interested in how contemporary that world seemed. My interest really does stem from Tombstone. And Mr. Jarre did not have access to some of the new biographies, so some of his constructions of the story are not accurate, but they are defensible dramatically. No, Johnny Ringo and Doc Holliday didn't fight it out at the end. Johnny Ringo was probably a suicide. Everybody at the time agreed that that's probably what had happened. But it makes a great arc. So yeah, I got interested. I started reading biographies of these guys because when I'm interested in something, I want to go for a person. I was just completely hooked when I read Karen Holliday Tanner's biography, Doc Holliday, A Family Portrait. She is his great-grandniece, and she had access to family memoirs and the Bibles. They didn't even have the date of his birthright prior to this, because the family was very closed about this. They stopped talking about him when the gunfight happened, not because he was involved with the gunfight, but because he was identified publicly over the AP wire, and it really was a wire then, it was the Associated Press Telegraph wire, as a sporting man, as a professional gambler. And we just accept that today. Because, you know, you watch poker on television, for God's sake. To be a professional gambler in the 1800s was like being a whore. You were doing for your living what respectable people did for recreation. You were taking money for something that you should not. And so he was profoundly ashamed of that. And in both of these two books, I have tried to be true to that man's reality, rather than to just accept the caricature of him that's been pushed through all of these movies and other books. It's sometimes sloppiness and sometimes genuine ignorance.
So we talked a little bit about why his family, besides the fact that he was was a sporting man.
Yes.
Thank you. You can't open those with one hand. I was like, well, that'll be really nice.
Stick it between my knees here.
Why else was this family ashamed of him or didn't want to acknowledge Doc Holliday?
Well, it came down to this public information.
Shaming.
The public shame over him
being the family.
They literally got to the point where they said that he didn't. They would tell the younger members of their families. This is now in the 1920s and 30s when the name starts coming up in the books about Wyatt Earp. They would say, "Oh no, he's just a fictional character. He's only in dime novels." Well, by the time Karen Holliday Tanner was writing her biography, people had kind of gotten over that. And so, like, in the same way that I'll tell you that my grandfather did time for armed robbery, my father is really embarrassed by that. He's ashamed of that. For me, it's just a fun story. Because I didn't have to grow up with him. I didn't have to feel that. And the other thing was, and this is probably what you're referring
right.
to, John Henry Holliday was born with a cleft palate and a cleft lip. Now, that's a shock, even today, when we know it can be surgically repaired, right? But in 1851, this is Southern gentry. These are people who believe in good breeding, and they mean that literally. A sign of a genetic fault that they didn't want anybody to know about. And so ordinarily a kid like that would have been hidden and probably would have died of starvation or pneumonia within the first 6 months of life. That commonly was how things happened. As it turned out, however, John Henry Holliday's uncle, John Stiles Holliday's father's brother, was a surgeon. And the operation, the surgical repair of cleft palates, had been in the literature of Germany and France, in the medical literature, and he was familiar with that. And so he and his cousin, Williamson Crawford Long, who has a hospital named after him in Atlanta, Crawford Long was one of the very first, if not the first, to use ether as an anesthetic. So the first pediatric surgery under anesthesia was performed on John Henry Holliday as a two-month-old baby. And his uncle repaired the defect, and his uncle's cousin was the anesthesiologist. So I said, it's just a remarkable family.
And his mother, talk about his mother.
Invented speech therapy for him. Because there was always, there's considerable difficulty with forming certain phonemes. She studied how to make the sounds, how to place the tongue and the lips to make the sounds. And she worked with him for hours every day. She made albums, and she would draw pictures and cut out things from magazines, and they would page through them, and everything was labeled. So he learned to read very young. She started his piano lessons when he was able to reach the keyboard, about three, and homeschooled him. In general, you know, it was this incredibly tight, very bonded, not to say enmeshed, mother-son relationship. She died when he was 14. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I just thought, oh God, that is such a tragic story. And then when you know his childhood, my feeling is that our first 14 years are the basis of everything that comes afterwards. We either build on a sound foundation, or we spend the rest of our lives trying to repair the damage, or we wander in the wreckage for the rest of our lives. And John Henry Holliday had a solid foundation with his mother. So he was working from strength. But to lose a mother at 14, my dad would tell you, you never get over that. It was just, to me, once you know that about him, you just can't buy the gambler and gunman that Hollywood made out of him. I thought this kid really deserves better than he's gotten from the movies and from fiction and from history. He didn't have a mama to love him when he was grown. So I took John Henry Holliday for my own. I just loved that child. I really did love him.
Well, why do you think the mythology grew up that he was Wyatt Earp's sidekick? I mean, why was he not?
Well, because, you know, it's like taking this 30-second misdemeanor arrest that went so badly wrong on October 26th of 1881, and making it into, you know, the central moment in Wild West history. You have to simplify things. It becomes the gunfight at the OK Corral, because it takes way too long to say the gunfight in the vacant lot behind Camilla's Fly's photography studio at the corner of, you know, so it becomes the gunfight at the OK Corral. Easier to say, easier to remember. It was big news even at the time. It's also very important, if you're going to make drama out of this and you don't want to write 585 pages, it's important to simplify it so it becomes the lawmen versus the cattle rustlers, right? Think of every version of this story you ever watched. It's the lawmen versus the cattle rustlers. One of the big surprises to me as I did the research for Epitaph was cows were not involved in any way. This was not about cattle rustling. And I'm taking some flack on the internet here because, in fact, it was about gun control. It really was. The misdemeanor was that it was illegal to carry guns in the city of Tombstone. It was actually more illegal, and that was true in Dodge City as well, where Wyatt Earp also was a part-time policeman. It was even more draconian in Tombstone. You couldn't carry any lethal weapon at all, including knives. You had to check anything that was a lethal weapon when you crossed the city limits. You checked it, you got a number, and you could check it on your way out. Okay? And part of the reason for this, and one of the things I try to do is, you know, what's the context that all this is happening in? President Garfield was the one who was shot by the disappointed office seeker. You know how they always say, disappointed office seeker, Charles Guiteau, shot the president. Shot him in the back, walked right up to him, gun, and shot him. Shocking. This is only 20 years after Lincoln was killed. Garfield was also a Union general. Okay, so think about 20 years after Vietnam. it's still a live issue, boy. This is, and to this day, Vietnam, we know that that is still dividing the country. You saw that split that happened, and it stays there for the whole generation. So he was shot on June 22nd. It took him a long time to die. He died about 5 weeks before the gunfight. And in response to the attack on Garfield, the city of Tombstone put through these laws that you could not carry a gun in town. There had been, it had been worse and worse and worse. It was clearly getting, you know, rougher and rougher. And these were Northern Yankee Republicans in the city. And it was rural Southern ex-Confederates outside. So, the, you know, here's this split. It's Fox News versus MSNBC. It really was. I mean, they had two newspapers, and that was basically the split. And so it was, these guys were seen carrying weapons. And I take you through everything that led up to it, but it wasn't about cattle. It really wasn't. They were seen carrying weapons in town. And poor Virgil Earp was told by the sheriff, you go down there and disarm those men. That's why the gunfight took place. Everybody, I did a lot of research on officer-involved shootings. Boy, did that turn out to be topical.
Yeah.
Jeez, you know, there's been this drumbeat. And if you think of Trayvon Martin and George Zimmerman, okay, Trayvon Martin, in case you have forgotten him, in the plethora of shootings since then, he was the kid with the hoodie who was coming home from the 7-Eleven with his package of Skittles and got killed by George Zimmerman, who was like this cop wannabe. The emotional reaction to that shooting was very much like what we just saw with Trayvon Martin and George Zimmerman. It was nationwide, a reaction to the gunfight at the OK Corral. It was seen in the political context of Garfield's death. It was understood to be an officer-involved shooting, and one of the people who was killed was not armed. This is the last, Jeff Gwynn did a book called The Last Gunfight, and it wasn't the last time that anybody shot it out in the West, but it was the last time you could just, like, shoot it and shoot something and walk away. This is the first time that officers were held responsible. There was a long and very involved legal hearing for 30 days after the gunfight. And they were exonerated, and if you read Epitaph, you will understand why it is so hard to indict, let alone convict a cop, even if they have killed an unarmed civilian. So all of that, it's like right now. All this stuff was right now, except for they had hats.
Nice hats. Did you know when you started thinking about Val Kilmer?
And please, okay, he got fat. Who among us is lighter than we were in 1994? Just asking. Get off his case. Get off Mr. Kilmer's case.
Did you know then? I mean, when did that sort of interest turn into an idea for a book and then a second book?
I really can't remember when I started thinking that I can do something with this. Mm-hmm. I was kind of goofing around because I do tend to jump from genre to genre. And so sometimes it's just kind of a joke. I say, well, I haven't done a murder mystery yet. Maybe I should do a murder mystery.
And really?
Yeah. I mean, that's what I was thinking about. Yeah. And then, you know, that's floating around. Then I was starting to get interested in Doc Holliday, and I was thinking, well, now, what if there was a body and it had to be identified by the teeth?
Dentist!
And so that was kind of when I started thinking about it, you know, that was, oh, that's kind of interesting. I might be able to do something with that. The second book, though, I thought Doc, and I meant Doc to be standalone. Uh-huh. I really believed that so much, there have literally been 1,000 books written about the gunfight at the OK Corral. Fiction, nonfiction, fiction that thinks it's nonfiction.
Or nonfiction.
Nonfiction that thinks it's fiction. You know, I mean, it's, you know. So I thought there wasn't anything that I could add. clearly I got over that. But I had the alternative. See, here's the thing. Along with Karen Holliday Tanner's biography of Doc, there have been a number of other biographies that have been done just in the last 10 years of the more secondary characters. So we know a lot more about John Clum now than we used to. We know more, a great deal more about the McLowry brothers. There's a very good biography of them. There are even biographies of the Clantons, less known about them, but there is a paper trail. We know a little bit about Johnny Ringo. So there are no fictional characters in this book. These are all real people. And so I was able to take advantage of all of that. And my standard is that if we know something historical is true, I try never to contradict that. Rather than simply ignore some historical realness, I think that way then you go into the weeds, you lose the reality of these people. There were an awful lot of people, just Wyatt Earp, for example. Is he a hero or is he a bad guy? All right, because you guys have not, you've probably haven't read the book yet, but he went badly off the rails twice in his life. This man is responsible for at least 5 extrajudicial executions. And they were brutal. And somehow that gets to be okay. You know, we give him a pass. And I think I understand that. I think I understand why we gave him a pass, but if you're going to let Wyatt go with that, then you have to give Ike Clanton the pass as well. A brother was killed, justice was denied, revenge was exacted. It's the same thing for Ike as it was for Wyatt Earp. And so here's the thing of it. People either want to make him into the flawless hero of the lawless West, okay, or they hate him. And I know both people. I kind of got a whole different spin on this story when, after I talked about Doc at the Tucson Book Festival, when the book first came out, a woman came up to me afterwards and she said, "My name is Pam Potter. I am the great grandniece of Tom and Frank McLowry. Wyatt Earp killed my uncles." And she said, "And not only did they not go to Tombstone looking for a fight, they were on their way to my great-grandmother's wedding."
Oh.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, oh. And that was exactly my reaction was, wow, is that ever not what I expected to hear? I mean, a wedding, come on, it's Sarah Caroline's wedding. You know, suddenly, Tom and Frank McLowry are not just bad guys to be pushed through a plot. And so I said, "Look, I'm starting to think about writing about Tombstone. Would you be willing to vet the manuscript for me? I want to make sure that your family feels that I have represented their side of the story." And that was when I really got the sense that this is not Wyatt Earp's story. This is not just his story, or Virgil's, or Morgan's, or even Doc's. This is Tom and Frank McLowry's story. This is Ike and Billy Clanton's story. This is John Clum's story. This is, you know, there are a lot of people who were involved with this, and I think that they all need to be represented, and their involvement with this needs to be represented.
So talk a little bit about your process. You do all this research in libraries. You live in Cleveland, outside of Cleveland. So, you know, you've got some very good libraries, public and university libraries there, and lots of that.
Right.
And then what do you do with all that research?
I do a lot of book research, but I also, depending on the subject, I did have to spend time in Tombstone. I've been down there quite a bit. Anybody been to Tombstone?
I'm telling you.
It's the Arizona of Arizona, isn't it? Yeah, I mean, you take whatever you think of Arizona, crank it up to 11, and that's Tombstone. They are packing. You know, it's scope and carry, and it's loaded. You know, those folks are, it's a whole, you know, and they know I'm a Democrat, and
we're just very nice to one another.
I had to see what was down there, because I'm from Chicago originally, so I know the prairie, I know, but I never lived in desert. I needed to see that. The other thing that I did that gave me a whole different spin on this story was I actually did the Earp Vendetta ride which is 58 miles on horseback through the mountains around Tombstone, and it is evil. It is really bad riding, and I trained for it, and I'm pretty good on a horse. But if the horse stumbled, or if you didn't make a, you know, you're going over bad, bad terrain. Mm-hmm. And it's like the mountains down there are failed sandstone. They're like a gigantic pile of clinker brick. Mm-hmm. It's really hard on the horses, and if you go down, you will break your fall with either rock or cactus or both. So this is a dangerous area. I was staying in a hotel, right? So I had a shower in the morning, but I was on horseback for the 5 days. And I tell you what, I understand a whole lot more about what that was like for John Henry Holliday. And I also, having done that, it's very easy for people to kind of dismiss the 96-hour Vendetta ride because you're only seeing it on the screen. You try sit in a saddle that long. John Henry Holliday was a gambler. It's a desk job. He was dying of tuberculosis. Probably weighed 130 pounds, and he was 6 feet tall. There's a lot of bone coming in contact with a saddle. This could not have been easy for him at all. And I also realized that as I was writing, it was like, I don't think Wyatt Earp wanted this man on that posse. When you think about it, all the movies, in the same way that it becomes the lawmen versus the cattle rustlers, it becomes, Morgan Earp gets to be a plot device. He has to die. He isn't a real person. He's the person who dies so that Wyatt and Doc can ride out and revenge and avenge his death. Okay? Who's the last person you want with you if you're going to be riding hard over bad country for days after people who know you're coming for them? Let's pick somebody who might, you know, cough or collapse at the wrong time. No, I really don't think so. So rather than ignore how sick Doc was, I accepted that. I accepted that Wyatt Earp is heroic and evil. I have to make those dots connect. I have to make you understand, make myself understand, represent how a man who was so straight-laced and so by-the-book lawman becomes a guy who can empty not just one shotgun into Frank Stillwell, but to take a second one and empty that, and then take out a pistol and empty that. I mean, that body was so cut up, they thought at least five guys had been involved with it. It was just wild. This is one of the reasons why I decided that I wanted to frame the story as the Iliad. Because when Wyatt Earp goes after Frank Stillwell, and you see, you know, he's just shooting this body to pieces. It is Achilles dragging Hector around the walls of Troy 8 times. This is Homeric rage. And so it seemed really right to me that Doc was the Odyssey. This is the wily man made more so by his wanderings. And then you have Wyatt Earp, and this is Achilles, a man who is consumed by rage. So.
So when you're doing that research, let me go back to that. Do you make a lot, you have a lot of notes, and then, I picture that maybe you have this big, you know, you have a room where you write in, and there's a big, you know.
I do have a room where I write in. And I know that there are people who have, like, if you're writing a murder mystery, I think a lot of them, like, have the plot points on Post-its. And it's all around the room, and they kind of work from one side to the next. I have scraps of paper. I write a lot of notes, like on check deposit slips. Always run out of check deposit slips before the checks. Scraps of paper and stuff like that, and they go into files. But generally, I do not outline.
But you do not.
I do not, because for me, what happens. The first line of the next chapter depends on what the last line of this one is. So I have to feel where I am in the story, and I think this is called working organically, but because I'm a paleoanthropologist and never took a writing course, I'm pretty much an idiot savant. I believe that's called a writing organically.
And you never outlined for the sparrow or
no. Oh God, I had no idea what happened to the sparrow. Flying blind the whole way. I thought I'm going to end up with 2/3. I didn't know what happened to him. I knew it wasn't the hands. And that's about all. I knew something had broken this man, but I had this character who was funny and self-deprecating and strong and bright and didn't take himself too seriously, and something broke him. And I had two-thirds of the book written, so I had all the characters were there, and after a while, the subconscious is just really working on it. My husband is a software engineer, or was until last Thursday, he just retired. And he also has this experience of, you think about whatever you're working on, like the last thing before you go to sleep, and you wake up, and when you're still trying to, you know, hear what NPR is saying to you, and suddenly you've got it. Or just as you're starting to fall asleep, you know, both of us keep paper and pencil by our beds. We're scribbling things down. We both know what that means. Okay, you just found a patch for that problem. So yeah, I take notes. I have moments in my head, and I'm working hard to get to that scene and that scene and that scene. So in The Sparrow, it was that moment when Emilio comes out of the spaceship for the first time and flings his arms open and breathes in the air of another planet. And I knew that's what I was aiming at for that. I just, Friday morning, I just got to a moment in the book that I'm working on now that I knew I had been aiming at that moment. And now I know what the next sentence is going to be when I get home.
Is it easier to write pure fiction rather than like these two novels that are very, very closely adhere to history?
Yeah, yeah. I'm facing that right now.
Yeah.
The problem with The Sparrow was, you know, it's like in science, Any sensibly formed hypothesis, any question can be at least theoretically answered, okay? You can, you know, you have a model and you do a hypothesis, and you, if you don't know the answer, then you call up Karen Rosenberg, because Karen knows everything. Okay, you know, so you can find out. There are things you can find out. With fiction, you have to make it all up.
And you were a scientist.
Yeah, so yeah, exactly. So it was very bizarre. It took a long time for me to feel that I could play, with language, mm-hmm. and that I could just make things up. Right now, the seventh novel, I was talking to you about this a little bit earlier today. It's Romeo and Juliet in the copper country of the Upper Peninsula of Michigan. It's about the 1913 copper strike. And so I have a little, you know, I have a girl who was on the union side and I have a boy who was not. And they are embedded in this overall. Now there are two to three people who are relatively, they are somewhat known. But I've got a lot of latitude. Mm-hmm. And so I'm trying to decide how close do I want to stay. This is not as well known as the Gunfight at the OK Corral. There are numerous audiences for what I write, and I know that there are people in Tombstone who know every last detail of everything. And I was so pleased to hear from a girlfriend that all the stores in Tombstone are really pushing Epitaph.
Oh, good.
I took them seriously. I went down and asked them questions. I was there and took people out for beer and, you know, said, here, what do you think about this? So they're happy with what I did. But with this one, there are very few people who really know this story outside of the folks who live in Calumet, Michigan. And they either take one side or the other. They're either pro-union, or they think that the union destroyed the copper industry and that's why nobody has a job anymore. So I need to go back and forth on this. And I was helped with that by the fact that I had put it on Facebook.
Follow me on Facebook. I love Facebook.
I said, I'm thinking about doing a story about the 1913 copper strike in Calumet, Michigan. And I need people of Finnish extraction. Is anybody out there who's Finnish who can answer some questions for me? And so I got a bunch of people, and they've been very, very helpful, and it's really been great. But I also heard from a girl who's in my own congregation at home. And she said, my great-grandfather was the last man to die in the mines before they called the strike. And I went, oh, I really need to take you to breakfast tomorrow because I need to. Well, Rivka was wonderful. I mean, she had the whole family. She had photographs of everybody. Solomon Cavisto was the last guy who died in the mines. And I had, at that point, was thinking, because my politics are such that I was like real pro-union, and the CEO was my bad guy, right? And Rivka drew me up short, just the way Pam Potter did, and she said, in my family, Annie Clements, who was the woman who called the strike, and James McNaughton, who was the CEO of Calumet and Heckler Mines, were both spoken of with reverence in our family. And I went, whoa, okay. Now it's moments like that where I go from telling the obvious story to telling a much more nuanced story. And so I'm kind of trying to pull you around every time you think that is it. He was, James McNaughton was the most progressive mine operator in the world. And he was a vindictive son of a bitch. His attitude was, how dare you ask me for anything after all I've done for you? Okay, so I'm trying to pull you back and forth. And Annie Clements, here's this 25-year-old girl. She has been elected the head of the Ladies Auxiliary of the Western Federation of Miners Local 15. And she's the one who called the strike. She called out 15,000 miners. And they left, they laid the tools down and walked out because Annie Clements told them to. That's how powerful she was. 6'3". Gwendolyn Christie. Have you seen Game of Thrones?
Yeah.
The big blonde girl? Yeah. Oh, man, she'd be perfect for this role. And when they made them, it's just a stunning, beautiful girl, but it towered over everybody else in the town. Just a striking girl. And yet, so to speak, that was not intentional. And yet it was a terrible decision. They had no strike fund. It was already July. The Upper Peninsula, you get 20 feet of snow. Okay, they have winters to reckon with, and they didn't have any planning for this. She called him out after Solomon Cavisto died, and she just decided, not one more. Not one, because it was a man a week. That was considered just normal industrial wastage. You signed your name, you took the job, that was the chance you took. And she just said, that's it. Not one more husband, not one more son, not one more brother, not one more. And she called him out. So now that's my setup, but I got a lot more play. How much do I want to use? I could go anywhere with them.
And is that scary? Or
it is. It's because I have this sense of responsibility to the people that I'm representing. So I want to be honest about the people. I don't want to make James McNaughton into an evil villain guy, because I know that he was very progressive for his time. I don't want to make Annie into a feminist heroine, because I know that things went badly wrong because she was just, she didn't pay attention to what the union told her. They said, wait until next year and don't strike Calumet and Heckler. We're gonna strike the smaller mines all around them, get them to agree to an 8-hour day and $3 a day, and then Calumet and Heckler will have to change in order to keep their miners from going to the other mines. That's perfectly rational, right? She didn't even think of that. That was like that. She just moved too quick. So that's what I'm trying to do. Is like these are real people making flawed judgments, and I want to represent that.
Before we take some questions from the audience, I wanted to just revisit with you years ago when after The Sparrow was published and you and I talked. I said, it was so clear to me that you had kind of fallen in love with Emilio Sandoz.
I was much younger then.
Well, I don't know, because Doc Holliday, I mean, I think you have a warm feeling for Doc Holliday.
I was very maternal about Doc. See,
well, that's
changed.
What they all say.
No. Okay, with Emilio Sandoz, I was 42. You know what they say about 40-year-old women. And it's true, it's all true. And my husband, my husband and my son would go off to school and work, and And then I would scamper upstairs and see them. It was like having a noonie with Amelia. And I overheard my husband telling somebody she's completely infatuated with a fictional celibate. How much safer could sex get? So he was quite aware of the fact that I was completely, you know, like really, really into Amelia. But by the time we got to Doc, my son was 22 at the same age, that was the same age that Doc left home and went west in hope of a cure for the tuberculosis that had just killed his mother just a few years earlier. So, you know, he began to die when he was 21. That's the first line of the book. My son and his wife, at that age, at 22, Dan and Jess filled the back of a Pontiac Vibe with everything they could stick into it and drove west. I mean, it's not a Conestoga wagon, but they went west. And, you know, they were going off into the unknown where my son was hoping to get work in Hollywood. He's a film editor. We have IM, we have phones, we have Facebook, you know, we have all these ways of communicating, but I still had my 22-year-old boy driving off into the sunset. And that was exactly the sense that I had as I was writing about Doc. I knew what it meant to be a 22-year-old man who had been sheltered much of his childhood, who has a mother who's just nuts about him, and who yet respects his manliness and is willing to let him be mature and go and do what he needed to do. I really had a very maternal reaction to John Henry Holliday.
Do you think that this new book, Epitaph, is it's not a sequel to Doc?
It doesn't have to be read.
Right.
Yeah.
I think that's important because I think
it's like the Iliad and the Odyssey. You can read about Odysseus without really knowing too much about what happened in Troy. You can read the Iliad without reading the Odyssey. They inform one another. The more you know about both of them, there are resonances. And I certainly, shamelessly, salted references to Back and Dodge throughout Epitaph in the hope that if you read this one first, you would go by Doc. I do think that they stand completely alone, but I think that they work better as a pair.
Do you think your interest in, is it your interest in Westerns that, or is it your interest in the people?
Always the people, yeah. I didn't say I want to write a Western.
Right.
Because that's even dumber than writing science fiction. You know, it's like, oh my God, there's only nobody's looking for Westerns these days. So I knew that this was going to be kind of a tough sell. No, I got interested in the person. I got interested in Doc Holliday in particular. And then I had to construct the world in which he lived. And one of the things that was most interesting to me in writing for Doc and for writing that book was that we always take like the isolated boom towns and the cattle drives and the settlers and it always takes place like it's on another planet, which is exactly why the series Firefly worked. You know, because it does take place. It's a Western, but it's on a different planet. It's on a whole bunch of different planets. And it works because it's the isolation that you get from it. Well, think about what's going on in the 1870s and 1880s. Standard Oil, Edison Illuminating Company, the incandescent lighting, the telephone, the phonograph are being developed. It's the era of Tchaikovsky and Verdi and Brahms and Schumann. It's the fluorescence of European culture. Wagner is writing, Carmen, Bizet is writing. It's absolutely the most, the highest development of Western civilization. And that's the culture that John Henry Holliday was bred for and educated for and was supposed to live within. And suddenly it's either die or leave all that behind. And now you're on the rawest edge of the frontier in Texas
listening to Buffalo Gals, Won't You Come Out Tonight, for the 90th time, played on a piano that's out of tune. You know, and you're coughing up a lung, and it's like, yeah, he was crabby. Defy you to feel good under those circumstances. So, I fell in love with him and then had to build his world. And it's the same thing with Annie Clements. I just thought, oh, how does a 25-year-old get to this place? How does she become so powerful in her world in 1913 that she can say, we're going out, and have 15,000 men listen? How do you do this? So I get interested in that, and now I have to build her world and build her sociology and her relatives and everything else, right, and make that work.
So is the writing as enjoyable as the research is to you?
Yeah.
Because you love the research.
I do love the research, but the research is there for a reason. And the moment when I'll be, like something just snapped into focus for me a week ago. Just a Monday. Until last week, this seventh book has been like, I don't know if I can make it work, but people always say, what are you working on now? So, well, in 1913, on Christmas Eve, 59 children were killed because their parents were trying to unionize the copper mines in Michigan. So it was just an elevator pitch. But a week ago today, it suddenly snapped into focus, and now I'm totally committed. Now I can't wait to get back and go on with it. Until that moment, and it was, I had been thinking Romeo and Juliet, and just hadn't really sat down to read the play, and I'm just reading the thing, you know, two houses, both equal in dignity. And I had already written chapters where first you see James McNaughton get up first thing in the morning, and here is this upper middle class person. He's got a shower, he's got a butler, and he's got a cook, and he's got, I just take you through his morning, and you get a sense of how progressive he is as a CEO. And then the second house is Annie Clements' house, and I take you through her morning too, and now you see everything that he was so proud of and that you're thinking, wow, that's really pretty good. I didn't know. I mean, they even had medical. He matched their medical insurance dollar for dollar. They kicked in a dollar, he kicked in a dollar. And it was really, really remarkable, right? And then you find out that, of course, they're not paying enough for people to kick in. So if you're a trammer and you're only making a dollar a day pushing 16 tons of copper up, you know, and your hands are bleeding and infected because you can't afford gloves, suddenly it looks different. So I thought, okay, and then I found another quote from Romeo and Juliet, and another one, and another one, and another one, and on there, okay, this is going to be good.
For just one second to say that the registers generally close at 8, they might give you a couple more minutes here, but if for some strange reason you haven't bought the book yet, you may want to go do so in the next few minutes.
Oh, for the love of God, yes. All my books. No. Go, my books.
So let's take a couple questions, and then we'll let Mary sign the books you're going to purchase.
Yes.
I'm very interested in your portrayal of the Clantons. Were they people that you actually were able to find a lot of information about, or is that particularly the relationship between Old Man Clanton and his children, or is that something that you had to create?
Old Man Clanton and his children were well known in the area. Mm-hmm. Okay, they and there is a modestly good biography. I mean, there isn't a great deal known about them, but it's 175 pages. And yes, the business about him going with all of his older sons from place to place and having them sign up to be Confederate soldiers, and they get the signing bonus. They'd stay just long enough to get the signing bonus that they take off in the middle of the night, go to another state, and do it again. He did, in fact, take them to California.
All of that is correct. He did buy a place in the middle of nowhere and thought it was going to be Clantonville and waited for people to come and make him mayor. He was known for brutal rages. And this, I think, is one of the most important things that that my books bring out that nobody else has done. Wyatt Earp and Ike Clinton had a great deal in common. They were exactly the same age. They were both the sons of men who were known for ungovernable rages. They both had younger brothers that they protected from their father's rage. And those younger brothers both died in Ike and Wyatt's arms. Okay? So there, you know, there's a real commonality there. And we also know, here's one of those things that people just decide, well, this is too complicated, so I'm just going to pretend it didn't happen. We know that Wyatt Earp made a deal with Ike Clanton that summer. Ike was going to rat out three guys who had robbed the Benson stage, and he was going to get the...
Robert, University Bookstore will be closing in 10 minutes. Can't make your final selection.
He was going to get the reward. Ike would get the reward, and Wyatt would get the glory of having brought in these guys. And, not incidentally, he would have cleared Doc Holliday of a completely spurious accusation. And so they trusted one another well enough to make that deal. Okay, you can't just walk away from that and pretend that it was always wrong. Ike, I think, was badly damaged by his childhood. He was certainly badly concussed the night before the gunfight. No question. I mean, he was out cold for an hour and a half. Okay, we know what a head injury like that does. And what did he do when he got up? He went out drinking all night long. Worst thing you can do. That stuff was all real. He did have a cafe, too. Ike was a good cook. There is still a cafe named Ike's Cafe in Tombstone.
I've read all of your books except Thread of Grace, and I have read Epitaph, and I love it.
Thank you.
I really appreciate the way in which you integrate science unapologetically and educate us in all of your books. So, I guess I want to know is how do you speak to all of us who have a charming little science geek inside of them, but you do it in a non-geeky fashion, and thank you. Or are you still teaching gross anatomy?
No.
You're not?
No, I am not. My department was shut down.
But now you're teaching us here.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. And I do try, I have people who read for me as I'm developing chapter by chapter and then full start to finish manuscripts. And if they will tell me, Mary, nobody wants to know as much about 19th century dentistry as you know. So I really, really, really need to cut this back. And you know, and I got into every, I'd give you a whole biography on everybody. And they said, we really don't care that much about John Klumb. You need to cut him back. So they will respond to me when I've gone into the weeds on stuff. Yeah.
Is in your book, Doc, you said that you have it, I think. I wanted to know if it's a direct quote where you have Doc Holliday say 90% of the Texans are given the other
10%
a bad name. Yeah.
Is that a direct quote from Doc? That one is not, but I'll tell you what is.
Oh, but here's my follow-up question then. My friend here wants to know if you feel that about Texans.
Don't confuse me with my characters. No, I had very good times in Texas, but I wouldn't want to vote there. The thing that is a quote from Doc, and this is where I got his voice, we have very little in the way of quotes from him. And by the way, I'm your Huckleberry is not something he said. That's from a novel that came out in 1929. He did say, I have enjoyed about as much of Texas as I can stand. He did not like Texas. I have had good times in Texas, but Doc was not a fan.
So Mary, I want to thank you, and let's give Mary a